I was reminded of Peter, you know, silver and gold I have not, none, but take up your mat and walk. I said, no, sorry, we don't have any money, but we're offering spiritual readings and miracles. And what I was, in theory, like what I was saying to her kind of was, we're offering prophetic words and prayer for healing. But it was kind of, I just felt like that was what I should say in that moment. And that kind of opened up kind of an opportunity to speak to her. She was like, whoa. We are walking solutions to people's problems, you know? Everyone's got stuff going on with them, and we are carrying the answer to that. We are carrying the Holy Spirit in us. We are vessels, temples of the creator of the cosmos. And guys, I don't really know what to say other than it's easy. It really is easy. There's a generation now who are rising up with fire in their eyes. And I'm thinking, you know what? I just want to go for this. I don't care if I fail. I don't care if I look stupid. I don't care if people think that, you know, I'm an idiot. I just want to have a go. I just want to see something, you know? I just want to live out like a Christianity that makes sense, like with the way I read the Bible.
You have the authority to release the Holy Spirit. And you have the means to prophetically step up and release someone's healing.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Seeing People Healed on the Streets by Christen, Forster and Dave Jones of River Church, Marlow.
So I want us to be hungry. There is so much that could be said. You know, we're driving over and I was thinking, what do we say tonight? Because since 2003, I felt the Lord really said, you need to prioritize my presence. And that was the first, spoke a message on it. And the Lord has shown us so much about what that means. But actually, we have to be hungry. Because actually, we can get content with what we've got. We can get content with manna in the wilderness. And, you know, I mentioned, you know, we can tell story after story. It just happens all the time. And it's not about, we don't feel like experts in any sense. But what we are seeing is a culture happening within the church, which is learning to live in communion with God through the Holy Spirit at levels that they had not done forever. And so from the young people to the old, because it's not just young. You know, Dave is our youth pastor, so he's told you lots of stories about the youth. People are experiencing the presence of God with them in new ways. And out of that is out of the overflow of that. You see, what I was driving at, and I wasn't very clear earlier, is the experience I had of God when I got healed gave me a confidence in his goodness that would take risks, that knew he was beyond what I could achieve. Submit your plans to the Lord that it may go well with you. Don't lean on your own understanding. All of those sorts of things. It, without the experience of that kind of presence with us, we do not have the confidence to step out in what God is asking us to do. The mind stuck in the flesh, says Paul, is unable to please God. When I look at evangelism and everything else out of the terms of what I have and my resources, I can't do it. But I cannot do it out of God's resources without the experience of his love over me, knowing that he is with me. We could tell you story after story that would seem trivial. They would seem absolutely trivial to say standing up here, but they are absolutely fundamental because for the people they happen to, they are the encouragement that God is with them. One of the things I often say is, you know, there's a time when the Pharisees come and Jesus has been healing people all day and he's just fed 4,000 and they say, give us a sign. And he says, no. Okay, because, well, what's he been doing all day? Well, the thing is, the point is, they were not signs to convince people who don't want to believe. They were signs of God's love for the people who received them. When Isaiah looks forward and he sees the virgin birth, he says, this will be a sign to the house of David. Behold, a virgin shall conceive. If, you know, the point is, that sign was primarily to Mary. She was the house of David. You trace her genealogy, she was part of the house of David. She knew the truth of whether it was a virgin birth or not. Theologians and Bible scholars can debate it as much as they like. In the end, the sign was not given for them, it was given for her. Does that make sense? See, that what God wants to do, and so actually, I could stand here and I could tell you trivial story after trivial story, but they're not trivial stories, because they are the thing that give us the courage and the confidence of God's love for us, and that he will have that same love for somebody else, that something that will mean something to them will happen for them. So what I wanted to do is, I just want us to be able to step in something here tonight. We could speak, and I can't see any clocks because I think it doesn't work. It's over there, 9 o'clock, so we got till 10. I would say absolute priority is making space for the presence of God, both personally and corporately. Personally, Jesus says time and time again, abide in me. In my Father's house, there are many abiding places. Always the same word, meno, means remain or to rest or to wait, to take time in. Take time in me. Take time in me. In my Father's house, there are plenty of places to take time. We need to cultivate lives that learn to dialogue with the Lord. And to dialogue, we have to wait for him to speak back. Otherwise, it's just monologue. So personally, we need to make spaces for that. Corporately, we need to make space for the things that encourage the presence of God. Worship and ministry. We need to make sure. We made the decision early on as we went for this. We would never do a public meeting where there wasn't the opportunity for ministry. Why? Because we don't want to get into a place where we're trying to be God for someone else. We always want to make space that actually whatever's been prompted by what's been said, wherever else, there's always that place that you can just meet with the Lord. The presence of God is absolutely fundamental. You see, you will see other things happening without it, but actually it's where we cultivate the lifestyle that allows our sonship, our royalty, to be expressed. Because we know that he's with us. I just... what we want to do is, I'm going to ask folks to stand, and I want us to be able to pray for those who are sick tonight with an expectation the Lord will touch and heal. I don't want to be too pretty on the spot. We prayed for Marianne before. Marianne, did you want to say anything about what's happened to you? I can say it, can I? Well, tell me if I get any wrong, because you couldn't lift your arm, could you? Because you damaged your ribs before Christmas. And you had pain down the left side, was it? And with osteoarthritis, and you can now lift your arm, can't you?
Wow.
Yeah. And the pain?
No.
No pain.
Awesome.
No pain. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I just what I'd like us to do is we're going to pray for those here. We're going to do it together. Not, you know. So if you've got things in your body that need praying for, let's stand for each other, and let's release the goodness of God for each other. Because one of the things I said earlier is, you see, for Jesus' disciples, it took seeing some things to really convince them. So we need to start, there needs to be something that happens in the house as much as it feeds what then happens out of the house. Does that make sense? You know, in the house is where we practice. In the house is where we get encouraged and we can hear the stories. And can I say another thing is, make space for testimonies. You know, we regularly give that space, come and tell stories, because actually, testimonies release faith for more, and things start to crescendo and build. So make space for testimonies. So if you've got pains and aches or things that you know you need praying for, if you just raise a hand, because we want to pray for people. Okay, so can we look around and see where there are hands? I was in Debenhams this last week, and I was talking to the girl on the cash point. She was friendly, and I just thought, oh, you know. So I dropped some things in. I thought, I bet she's a Christian. I'll give her a word. And I said to her, are you musical? And there was this immediate kind of like, she checked across to the till next to her, and the person looked over, and it was kind of, uh-oh, freaky customers just stepped over a line they're not supposed to. So I kind of just backed down and said, never mind, it's okay. But I went away thanking the Lord that actually now I'm that's fine. You know, I have other stories, you know. When I went to the hairdresser the last two times, I prayed each time. You know, I don't go that often, but the last two times I've gone. And I said, the first time I said, you know, if I get, there's one lady hairdresser where I go, and it's all the rest of the guys. I said, if there's a lady hairdresser that does, then I think I've got this word for her, but I'll only give it to her if it's her, because, you know, one in four chance. And of course it was. So, you know, I just gave this very simple word, and she kind of went, wow. She said, are you like one of those spiritualist churches? And I kind of, and in the kind of the flow, I kind of went, well, something, but not quite. you know, that sometimes you get it right, sometimes you get it wrong. But most things in life, we don't learn to get right except by the practice and getting things wrong. So we've really got to become confident and not worry. So, okay, there's no arrhythmic heart, but I'll go with some. Is there anyone with carpal tunnel syndrome or repetitive strain in the left hand? None at all? Oh, yes, there is. There are. Okay, there are a couple there. Okay. That one was okay then. and a lung infection as well. There's a lung infection here, okay. Those are just when I was praying earlier, three things that I felt. So what we're going to do is, if you raise a hand, I'm going to ask you just to stand first, and then I'll ask those around you to stand, because we are all sons and daughters of the living God. We all have the right to be known as children of God. We are all heirs of God, and we are co-heirs with Christ, it says, if we suffer with him. And what it means by that, it doesn't mean that we're in the struggle with him. We're going to participate with him. And we're going to suffer with you. We're going to lay hands and we're going to deal with these sicknesses. And we become co-heirs with Christ as we do that. Okay, we can become co-heirs with Christ. So if you just kind of stand quickly first, and then those around you, you're going to stand next to them. We're going to lay hands on them. And we're just going to release healing. And we're going to expect in our heads, we're going to remind ourselves of the goodness of God, okay? And that if we as evil fathers know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more would our Father in heaven, does he want to do something here? One of the things I'm going to ask that we do as we pray is that we don't, because sometimes when people ask to be prayed for healing, what we do is we give them prayer ministry. Okay, we just want to really focus that the Lord does want to heal. No questions about is it the right time or anything. We just want to release the healing of God. Ultimately, God always wants to heal because we all know there is no sickness in heaven. Okay? And the only prayer that we've been given that, as an example, is to pray your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So who cares what the timings are at the end of the day? What Jesus has told us to pray is it will be like it will be in heaven. Are you sick today? Yep. Are you going to be sick in heaven? No. So let's pray for healing today. Let's not get bogged down in why is it the person got it too much. let's just go for the simple. In the end, God's pattern for heaven is this person won't be sick. We have been asked to pray that will into this situation. So we're just going to stand and we're going to release that to each other. So can we just do that? Can we do that? So if you need to raise a hand again if you need prayer. And particularly those that we just mentioned, not just that, but we'll come back to things. Okay, so Father, so can we invite the Holy Spirit to be with us? He loves to walk with us where two or three are gathered in His name. He is here, so the Holy Spirit is here. If you are with one of those people, just turn, lay a hand on them, ask them what they need praying for. Start to talk to the Father before you start praying for them. So don't do your kind of the initial praying straight at the person. Do your initial praying by connecting with the Father. Just ask, say, Lord Jesus, just give me faith for this person. Father, give me faith for your goodness to break in. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. And now just start to pray as the Spirit prompts, but pray for their healing. Pray for their healing. And what we're going to do is I'm going to allow a minute or so for this first wave of prayer. And then we're going to test some things, and then we're going to have another wave of prayer. I'll just tell you a quick story while you're praying. I won't tell you the whole story, but we had a man who got saved through Alpha, who had extremely advanced Parkinson's. And he came up one Sunday morning, and he was so depressed. And everyone in town, he'd been a barman before he lost his job, he'd been a pub landlord. Everyone used to call him Shaky Dave because of his Parkinson's. And at the church, everyone called him Shaky Dave because he shook. And he came up with tears, and he said, I'm so fed up with this illness, and there's nothing the doctors can do. Can you please pray for me? And I had no faith as I laid hands on him. But as I laid hands on him, I confessed to the Lord, I don't have faith for this. I knew, I had a conviction that it was wrong that we had called him Shaky Dave. I just knew it was wrong. And so I repented to the Lord and I just apologized to him and said, Dave, we should not call you Shaky Dave because this is not who you are. And I started to prophesy over him. Well, to cut a long story short, when he woke up the next morning, he wasn't shaking anymore. But what had happened was, he had had something prophesied into being. And if I, although I did not have faith when I laid hands on him, I found where I did have faith and I prophesied into it. And so as you're praying for people, just ask the Lord, what can I prophesy into being? How can I prophesy health into this person? Now, what I'm going to ask you to do is ask the person that you've been praying for, just if there's anything they can do to test what they had. Is there anything that they felt, or anything, any way they can test what's going on in their body? It's very important. It's actually something Jesus does. You know, he engages the person with their own healing, as you read through the stories. If they had stiffness in a joint, can they move it without stiffness? If it was a back, can they bend over? There are some things that you can't test on the night. That's fine. Has anyone felt anything going on in their body? Is there any change in people's body? Hey, amen. Do you want to come out? These are encouraging stories. Can you tell me what was wrong with you?
Well, I suffer from bad hiatus hernia.
A hiatus hernia.
Yes, terrible acids and regurgitation. But as they prayed for me, I actually felt the gurgling bubble, like lust of the... And before I came here, I said to John, it's amazing, John, I've been well. Now I want to go to the church. I'm actually feeling sick. Mm-hmm. I don't even want to go. And it's actually just gone. And in my knees, I suffer from very bad osteoarthritis. And my knees very stiff and tight. But I'll be very honest, they are very loose.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Amen. I just want you, do you know this lady?
Granny.
You do know this lady? Is she a truthful lady?
Yeah.
Amen. Thank you.
While I was praying, I got a real picture of what was going on inside her stomach.
Amen. Fantastic. And tell the stories on Sundays. So you're 100% better. No gurgling and joints free. Fantastic. Anybody else felt something going on in their body? Come on, do you want to come forward? Go on, you tell your story.
So when I was running Sunday morning, because it was beautiful on Sunday morning, so I decided to go for a quick 13-mile run. So I'd already gone, sort of was on my way back. And then on the 12th mile, my calf seized up and I thought, that shouldn't really happen. I sort of walked a little bit and I thought, no. And luckily for me, I normally take my bus pass just in case, so I sort of got on the bus and sort of came, sort of got home. So I managed to go to church later in the afternoon. But while Steve and Sophie were praying, I sort of felt some warmth actually down the whole leg. And it's a lot better than what it was this afternoon. So I'm thinking of maybe another session in the gym.
So what would you call it? What's the percentage better?
I'll say about 80%.
Right, well, let's pray for the last 20. So let's just reach our hands. What's your name, sorry?
Akin.
Okay, Father, we just want to pray, Lord Jesus, for the last 20, Lord Jesus. At one level, because our bodies are fearfully and wonderfully made, we know this pain would have gone eventually. But Akin, this is like when Jesus turned water into wine. You see, every year we turn water into wine through the vineyards. What he did was he did it supernaturally fast. Now, Father, we just release the last part of this healing, Lord Jesus, as a sign, Lord Jesus, to Akin that you are with him. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Can you keep stretching it? How's it feeling?
Not as stiff as it was this afternoon.
So any better than the 80?
Yeah, a lot better.
Fantastic. Okay, amen, Akin. Anybody else got anything happening in their bodies? Don't worry for those that haven't. We're going to keep praying. We're going to keep pushing because, you know, often we do, okay? And one of the things we've learned is not to give up the first time. There was a guy in one of our meetings with tinnitus, and a word had been given about tinnitus. And we did this where people in the church were just generally praying for each other. He ended up getting prayed 6 times, and on the 6th occasion, the tinnitus went. So I don't always understand why, but let's not give up too quickly. Okay, let's not give up too quickly. So anybody else felt anything? Just good to hear the testimonies. Okay, do you want to come and just share?
The pain's actually got worse.
Okay.
There's something else behind it.
Yeah.
I've been getting difficulty with my joints, but particularly my thumbs. And I've been unable to, or finding it really difficult to play the guitar or to type. And it's happening just at a time when I'm getting more opportunities and being asked to do both. Mm. And when Alison and Josie were praying, I could hear my mum saying, "It's selfish." She'd actually forbidden me to play the guitar,
right,
and said that writing was childish and selfish. And I can hear her.
Yeah.
So I think it may be more about that pain actually got.
Well, can we? So it is, at the moment it's worse,
yeah,
but you felt something, and there's been some revelation, because actually you're conscious of there being something that is a kind of effectively, and I say it carefully, but is a cursing of what sometimes it kicks it off. What's your name?
Claire.
Well, we're going to pray for Claire, okay? And what we're going to do, because you've given us more information, and if you read Mark's Gospel, really encourage you, if you want to look at how Jesus interacts with those he's healing, he often, there's little questions, or he separates them from the rest of the people, because there's often just those little keys that we do need to touch into. Sometimes we don't, and that's where it's easy, you know, it's just a straightforward healing. But the human psychology, you know, the emotions and the spirit and the body are all very interwoven. And so sometimes what we find is that a situation is a symptom of something else, and I think that's what you're saying. It's Claire, was it?
Yeah,
Claire. So, Father, we just lift Claire to you. Father, just right now, we want to break the power of the curse. And, Father, we just want to release her, Lord Jesus, from this spirit of infirmity that, Lord Jesus, has Lord Jesus robbed her of who she should be. And actually, I want to declare that he is a thief. He is a thief. He is a thief. The thief only comes to steal and destroy, but Jesus came that you should have an abundant life, which includes things like the musical gifts that you have. And so, Father, we just declare, Lord Jesus, that the musical gifts are gifts from you, Lord Jesus. That the joy that she gets, Lord, from playing are things that are from you. They are good things that you've sown into her. And so we come against the thief. And in Jesus' name, we speak to this pain, Lord Jesus, in her arm, this carpal tunnel, Lord Jesus, this repetitive strain injury. In Jesus' name, we rebuke it and tell it to go. Amen, amen, amen. Can you just stretch your arm a bit and tell me what's...
Yeah, it's still quite stiff.
Still quite stiff. Is it in both hands?
Yeah.
Okay, and is it just in the hands or in
just
the arms as well?
In the palms.
Okay. Okay. Father, Father, Father. Father, Father, Father. You're a good God who gives gifts to his children. Lord, who takes joy in our joys. Who says you want to give us the desire of your heart. And so, Father, we release your goodness into Claire's hands. Father, 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 we bless these hands. Lord Jesus, so many times in Scripture you say you want to bless the work of our hands. And Father, we claim those blessings. Father, it says in Galatians that we are heirs of the promises. And one of the promises is that as we walk with you, we will walk in health. And so, Father, we release that promise into Claire's hands in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Is anything happening? Still stiff. Still stiff. Okay, never mind. Well, I don't want to embarrass you, Claire. But what I'm going to encourage you to, one of the things I would encourage you to do, Claire, is where you've had revelation of that effectively a curse, is to start to really speak positively over your hands, because you have gifts in your hands that actually are part of who the Lord's made you. And let's start to just, and start to declare it for yourself. So I encourage you to keep doing that. Actually, one of the early breakthroughs for me, personally, was me doing exactly what I've just asked Claire to do with this horrible verruca I had on my foot, which was more than a verruca, it was really going somewhere nasty. And I just started to declare some things over myself. And one day it was gone. It just happened overnight. I couldn't believe it, because they were saying you're going to have it amputated, you know, cut out. But there you go, Father. So if those who still needs breakthrough, if you just raise hands, those that have been praying for are still looking for breakthrough, because we want to keep pushing for more. Okay, let's keep pushing for more. And if others want to move around, we're just going to all keep, let's keep exercising faith on their behalf. This is really important that we learn to do it, okay? It's really important that we do it together. So, what's your name?
Melinda.
We want to lift Melinda's breathing to you. Father, just say, Lord, you gave me a picture of lungs earlier, Lord Jesus, and I just come against, Lord Jesus, the shadowing and the infection, Lord Jesus, in these lungs. And in Jesus' name, we rebuke that infection. We rebuke the infection. and we rebuke the condition, and in Jesus' name we release your healing in your way, Lord Jesus, in Linda's body. Lord Jesus, Lord, may she know she's been touched by heaven. May she know that her Father in heaven has given her a good gift. Oh, come more of you, Holy Spirit. Father, I just pray for the heat of the Holy Spirit just to start entering into Belinda's lungs right now. That, Lord, she knows that you are giving her the physiotherapy. And Father, in Jesus' name, we just come against anything that has sought to attach itself, Lord, to this infection, that is trying to make itself a chronic situation, Lord Jesus. We break its power in her life, Lord. We break the cursing when someone's had a disease for a long time, has an illness for a long time, where they start to think, well, it's part of me. We break the curse of that. In Jesus' name, we release you. We release you, release you, release you. Breathe easily, breathe easily, breathe easily. If you take a deep breath, Belinda, can you feel things in your lungs? Is that how it works?
Yes, it feels tight.
It feels tight at the moment. And that's how you know that you've got the thing, because when you...
Yeah, I cough a lot, yeah.
Kishkadana, my Father, we want to release this tightness in Belinda's lungs, Lord Jesus, and in her chest. Come, Holy Spirit, come, Holy Spirit. Release, Lord Jesus, release them, Lord Jesus. Father's name, Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, we break the power of this thing over you. Lord Jesus, we say that from this hour forwards, its power is broken in her body. And in Jesus' name, this incredible body that you've given her, Lord Jesus, will kick this thing out in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 What I'd like to do, I'm just going to take quickly an opportunity. Is there anything else anyone would like to say, any things that are happening? At the end of the meeting, we're really happy to pray with anyone that wants to keep on praying for some breakthrough. So we will do that. Myself and Dave will stay. So we'll really want to take the time with everybody that wants to be prayed with personally. We will do that. But is there anything else anyone would like to share? One of the things I want to say... What was that? Okay. Well, we at the end of the time, we will we'll pray for those that want to stay, but it'll be good to release those that need to be released as well. But my prayer is this evening. You know, you saw we had a number of testimonies, and we recognise also where there wasn't breakthrough. Okay, and we're not trying to live in unreality. Okay, we don't want to live in unreality, but we must celebrate what God does do. Okay. We must celebrate what he does do. You know, gratitude is an incredible, what's the right word? It's a great hoster of the presence of God. God doesn't have favorites, but his favor seems to stick to certain people. And there are a number of things you always find with those people that his favor sticks to. And issues of gratitude and good attitude are very common. You know, it says that we enter his gates with thanksgiving. We enter his courts with praise. The place of revelation in his courts, we've entered by praise, but before we even get there, we start with thanksgiving. And it's one of those things, it's absolutely important that we celebrate what God has done. You know, Jesus tells the parable of the wheat and the tares. He says that at the appointed time, the angels come and harvest and separate the wheat from the tares. And so the reality is, there is something in that mentally in our minds which we can focus on. We can look at what God hasn't done, or we can look at what he has done. And it gives us faith that he's going to bring about the rest. I used to think that there was an unreality in declaring myself well when I wasn't there. And so I didn't want to go for it. But I had some revelation where I suddenly realized that I have a thing called a medullary sponge kidney, which produces kidney stones. And I was in a meeting, and a particular word of knowledge was given. It was actually by Bill Johnson for someone with a left kidney that needed to be replaced, and basically, you know, mine will go on producing kidney stones. It's a genetic thing, and so on. It's a bit spongy, produces stones. So I claimed that word, and then you say, well, have I got it or haven't I? You know, how do you use? But this is what I realised is that I absolutely know that in the resurrection, my body will be fine. So it means that if you take the sum of who I am, you know, and you match eternity with this life. The things that I carry in this life, but not into eternity, you know, if you divide any number by infinity, it comes out as zero. So actually who I am is not defined by what I've got right now. Does that make sense? Because actually in eternity it's not there. So somehow I mustn't own what I'm told by the doctors without being dishonest about it. Does that make sense? Not living an unreality, okay? So yeah, according to the x-rays, I still have stones in the kidneys and so on. But actually, in the goodness of what Jesus has done for me, he has bought me a new body, a resurrection body, with a good kidney. And so I won't be defined by those things that ail me right today. Does that make sense? And as we start to get hold of that perspective and live in it, so it's not hypocrisy, it's not unreality. We recognize where people haven't got broken through yet, and we don't always understand why, but we don't end up trying to put them in a little box so we stop pushing through for them, which is something we often do. So you can say, well, that's a bit complex. Things are complex sometimes. But actually, this is the maturity the Lord wants us to walk into, to learn more and more. Some of you will remember the healing testimony of a lady called Jennifer Rees-Larkham some years back. She had she'd been in her wheelchair for 17 years and been prayed for by absolutely everybody. And one day in a small group meeting with a new believer, said, can I pray for you? And pray for her, and she got up. You know, we don't always understand the timings, but let's not write off any situation. Father, coming out of this evening, in 2 weeks' time, what we want to be able to do, and just so you can put the word around, is we're gonna bring little anointing bottles, anointing oil bottles. Okay, and when Jesus sent out his disciples, if we read in Mark, it says that they went around anointing people with oil. Okay, something Jesus taught his disciples to do. And we want to give everybody here a bottle of oil. Because we used to use the phrase, we want every member in ministry. One of the things we now say is we want every member with authority. Okay, and you are clothed in Christ. You have an authority. You are allowed to anoint with oil. Just because it talks about the elders doing it in James doesn't preclude you from doing it. So there's nothing magic about olive oil. It's just the same stuff you get in Sainsbury's. In fact, it will be the same stuff you get at Sainsbury's. you know, or probably Asda, because Asda's cheaper. But you know, it will. But it is something prophetic. We need to start to learn to become comfortable with the prophetic. You know, God speaks what is not as if it is. It comes into being. He declares. And we are in his image, and we are his heirs, and we speak with that authority, and he likes us to speak out and find ways or act out. And that's one of the things we do with the oil, is we are prophetically putting the Holy Spirit into a situation. Yeah, it's not something ritualistic, it's not something sacramental or magical, it is something prophetic. So we want to give everybody a bottle of oil. And you keep it in your home, and if you see it, it's a reminder that you have an authority to release the Holy Spirit into a situation. Okay? You have the authority to release the Holy Spirit. And you have the means to prophetically step up and release someone's healing. Okay, and we just want to encourage you to do it. And then as well as giving you the oil, what we want to do is my wife will be there here next week as well. And probably myself and Dave and Judith. And we just want to be able to lay hands on folks. And anything we've got, we want to be able to give it away. Sometimes when we think about the laying on of hands, we can get quite magical about it. But there is something about that physical connection. And there is something I'm very happy to be laid hands on by any believer that has got some breakthrough in something. You know, I'm quite happy if they want to pass it on to me. So it's not a hierarchical thing. It's just saying, look, for what we've been doing now since 2003, what we've been trying to push into, where we've got victories, where we've got breakthroughs, where we've got some understanding, if there's something we can just do to say, lay hands and say, Father, we want them to have it. Because absolutely, I believe that the hope for the world is Jesus' bride, the church. If we're going to be what we're supposed to be, we will need to step up into a new way of working. I actually believe it's the way of working that the early church knew by instinct, and unfortunately, because it was so obvious, it's not always explicit in Paul's letters and writings because it was so obvious. So the things that Paul writes about are the kind of almost the side details very often because he just expects that we know this. You know, he addresses in the book of Corinthians the Corinthian church is surprised that some of them have been sick and some of them have died. See, they're surprised. what's this? Some of us have died and some of us are sick. So I'll have to explain to you what's going on. So Paul has to write and explain it. The trouble is, what we've done is we take the passage and it's just a kind of an excuse for why people die and get sick. But actually for them, it was the shock of the first people dying who are followers of Jesus. They've never had followers of Jesus dying before. He's only been around, they've only been a church for a few years. And suddenly they're dealing with the fact that sometimes Christians do die and sometimes Christians get sick, but it's a surprise. That makes sense. And I think the Lord wants to step us back into where what it is, everything it is that Jesus died for us. I want to emphasize again, in the end, there is no substitute for submitted time to his presence. There is absolutely no substitute for it. We've got to learn a hunger for it. Very often, and I would say this, I thought I didn't have a hunger for it. But when I had all these problems with my kidneys and I went, you know, I had to go into hospital and have some stuff. And one of the things they told me is that I was always dehydrated and that was a problem. And they said, the trouble is most people in the UK are dehydrated. And they told me that the reason why is because when you're dehydrated, the message that comes to your brain is that you're hungry. Because in most cultures, if you were hungry, you'd go and eat a piece of fruit which has fluid in it. Does that make sense? So when you're dehydrated, the message that goes to your head primarily is that I'm hungry, and so people eat too much. And in actual fact, their bodies want fluid, but they're eating food. And they're eating food without fluid in, so they become cyclic. And actually, I would say that is true. So many Christians is, we think we're not hungry for the presence of God. We think we're not thirsty. We think we want something different. But actually, as we start to get disciplined in taking time in his presence, we become more tuned in. So now I'm far more conscious when I am thirsty than I ever used to be. Does that make sense? I've been retrained to notice when I'm actually thirsty, not hungry. But actually, for so many years, I just thought I was hungry. Okay, and actually, you will be thirsty for the presence of God as the deer pants for water. So my soul longs after you, writes the psalmist. That is who we are made to be. We are made to be receivers of the love of God in a way that actually we are aware of and we've learned to touch. As we go on in it, you discover that he develops a love language with you. I have private jokes now with the Lord. And they are absolutely part of that presence thing that I was talking about. And they're just little moments, and I see things as I'm going through the day and I know the Lord's talking to me. And you say, are you just fooling yourself? Well, if I am, it's very fruitful. It becomes very fruitful. He starts to develop a language with you. It's very personal, based on your relationship with him. But you've got to give space for it to be a dialogue, not just a monologue. And you do it corporately. And take risks. Okay. You know, you cannot do it without taking risks. And sometimes you'll get it wrong. And you know what kills the authority in the spirit is the religious spirit. Because often the religious spirit sounds so logical as it picks away at what's going on. But it is a thief. It really is a thief. And so you think, well, why should I do it that way? You know, why does it have to be this way? Well, it doesn't have to, because we're not tied to laws. But actually, if this is what the Lord's doing, who am I to say, do it another way? You know, it says as they were about to enter the land that when you get in, you're going to go to the place that I appoint as my meeting space. Not any old place you feel like. You're going to go where I set my name. Okay? And there are places where the Lord is looking for us to become obedient to what he is doing and bringing our lives in line with that rather than saying, you can meet me where I am. In many ways, what I'm doing at the moment is like, you know, when Jesus says a sower goes out to sow, there are just phrases, and as they're coming, I was throwing them out. For different people, different things will make sense. Okay, but leave space for the Word of God to grow. You know, it says in 2 Chronicles 16, it says that the eyes of the Lord are roving to and fro on the earth, looking for someone to show himself strong in, someone whose heart is completely his. I just love that verse so much. Because, you know, sometimes we have that model. This is the religious spirit that says, if I'm good enough, then the Lord will do something through me. Whereas actually God is saying, if your heart is usable by me, I'm looking for someone that I can show myself strong in. If your heart is open to me, let me do it. And as I say, as we'll pray, we'll give you the oil, we want to commission you. And if you will use it, there will be stories and testimonies. And we did it, my wife did it a few years ago, which is why I wanted to be here, because she had this prophetic kind of sense of how to do this. And she did it with a congregation she was leading. River Church now has four congregations, and she was leading one. And people took them away, and we had some great testimonies back. I have a friend, Russell, who I walk the dog with, who has back problems, you know. And actually, one of the things he does know, he says now, is he actually has learned to recognize that when he is really walking close with the Lord, he doesn't get back problems, and when he isn't, it's almost like when he's close to heaven, his back has no problems. But anyway, he was having some pain one day, and he has a son, Isaac, who's 6 years old. And he was saying, "Oh, sorry, Isaac, I can't play with you because of my back." And Isaac said, "Well, we're going to pray for it then." And he ran and got the bottle of oil, because he had been at the meeting when they were given out. And he came back and said, "Can I pray for your back then?" And he prayed for his dad's back, and he got healed. Okay. I used to think I couldn't hear the Lord. Absolutely serious. Most of my, I had what was in earthly terms considered quite a successful Christian ministry. I remember saying to somebody when they said, I said, "I don't hear the Lord like you do," to the person. I said, "I kind of get senses over long periods of time. You know, I read my Bible and I get this sense of what we should do." And it had been quite effective. You know, every one of us can hear the Lord. Every single one of us can. Paul actually says, it's not hearing. He said, "We all, with unveiled faces, behold the image of Jesus." You know, we all have the ability to see with our imagination and hear with our imaginations. And we need to learn to become confident in knowing that it's when the Spirit is speaking. And so what we've found is, as we've taught folks to honour the presence of God, people's ability to hear Him has grown. And person after person, not just on the leadership, is now understanding how to get words of knowledge for people. And it's not a big scary thing. It's just, I just saw something, and I've learned in my spirit to recognize there was something of the mark of the Spirit. They've talked about compassion. Do you know, that's one of the ways I think Jesus knew what the Father was doing. You know, he says, "I do what I see the Father doing." It says he had compassion, then he moves in healing. You know, these are languages that the Lord uses with us. You'll be walking into a room, and as you look around, someone's face just captures you. And you think, "Oh, right, okay." So I was at our student work, and there was a girl there that I recognised, but I've never really talked to. And for some reason, when I was speaking, her face kind of was kept on coming up. So, there were two others as well, but just thinking about the first one. And so when I finished, I just said, "Okay," I said, "Well, I don't know your name, what's your name?" And I said, "I know that the Lord wants to say something to you, but I don't know what yet." And the only reason I knew it was because of the way, just while speaking, I just found I kept being drawn back. And then the Lord just said, "She's got an older brother." So I said, "Have you got an older brother?" And she said, "Yes." And then I had some things that followed on from that about her expectations and so on. But the thing I'm saying is you see that it started without the full word. It started just with this thing and noticing that somehow or other the Spirit was putting his finger on something. And as we learn to do it by practice, we become more confident in its reality. Does that make sense? It is only if we will step out and take the risk. So we have to become a culture that cheers people on more for trying than it does telling them off for failing. That's where I was going. Sorry, that's why I said the religious spirit will kill what you're trying to do. Because the religious spirit will say false prophet. A false prophet, because we made the mistake, because we got it wrong. Okay. Somehow or other, we need to build a culture here that cheers people on more for trying than tells them off for failing. Because if you're going to go for it and try, you will be falling over from time to time. Actually, I think it's part of the shaping process the Lord puts us through. Because in the end, it cannot be about how it endorses you, because everything works right. And what we found is, and I say this on a personal level, I've become more fruitful in praying for folks now that I'm less worried about whether they actually get healed and I get the glory for it or not. Does that make sense? So, but actually to get me to that place, I had to have some public failures and learned that actually in the end it didn't matter. We would still keep going to look to release the goodness of God. We'll still keep going after the goodness of God. And the great thing is, you know, I say the great, because actually I do want them healed. Really do. I loved what Dave says. I love the way sometimes Dave puts these things, but you know that the fleshy mind cannot understand things of the Spirit, which is why actually evangelism requires us to get hold of something in the Spirit that causes a change in the physical world. Actually breaks something here. Now, we're going to finish, but I just want to flag another key lesson we've learned, and I'm just kind of sharing quick things, is to know who you are in Jesus. And I don't just mean generally, because we did freedom in Christ or whatever. What I mean is, who are you? Who are you specifically? What is your story? What is it that he has called you to? What has he made you? And as people discover who they are, by revelation, which comes because they take time in his presence, they become far more fruitful. And they carry far more authority. Let's give you a very quick example from Scripture. And maybe from, but you know when Jesus says to Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter says, "Well, some say that you're the Messiah, some say you're a prophet." And he says, "No, but who do you say that I am?" And Peter says, "Well, you're the Christ, the Son of the Living God." And Jesus said, "Well done, Simon, Bar-Jonah," which is interesting, because Simon's dad's name is not Jonah, because Bar means son of. Okay, his dad's name is not Jonah; it's Johannes. It's not Jonah. And so some people just say, oh, it's a spelling mistake. I don't think so. I don't think it's a spelling mistake. Because Jonah was a prophet from Galilee. He's the only Old Testament prophet from Galilee. What Jesus is saying, you've had some revelation, Peter, you son of the prophet, you Galilean prophet, you fisherman prophet with fish all around you. It's a kind of little bit of a wordplay thing. Well done. You've had some revelation. And you say, but is it revelation to say that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? After all, didn't Andrew say exactly that to him? Flesh and blood, Peter's own flesh and blood, his brother. He's the one that came, if you read John, and said, come and see the one who's the Christ. But you see, it's not the same as information. We can be told something is information. What Peter has just had is revelation. And there is a big difference. You know, information might be logged as a fact in the head, but revelation changes us. And he says, you've had this revelation, and now I'm going to give you some more effectively. He says, you will be called Peter. This is Jesus prophesying now to him. So as Simon has spent time engaging and seen something about Jesus, Jesus turns it around and starts to prophesy into his own life and says, now you're Peter, you're the rock. And on this rock I'm going to build my church. Well, what's the rock? Is it Peter? Because he's called him rock. Or is it the revelation he's had that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? Or is it even the process of revelation? Maybe it's all of them. But he says, you're going to be the rock. But the thing is, Peter was a foundation stone in the church. He's the first leader of the church in Jerusalem. He is the leader. He is the first evangelist with the Gentiles. He is the first bishop in Rome. You know, he was a cornerstone. So what Jesus is doing is he's prophesying into Peter's life. But that prophecy has come as Peter has given his revelation of who Jesus is, you see? He has sought who Jesus is. Jesus turns it around and tells him something about who he is. And out of that place, Peter has an authority, which is recognized and exercised. So when Peter stands up they're having the council in Jerusalem and says, this is what we're going to do, he is not being arrogant. He is being obedient to the revelation the Lord has given him. And so he is able to do it. Okay? And here's the thing, every one of us, the Lord has a story for. Every one of you has a story with Jesus. But I am absolutely amazed at how many Christians do not know their story. You know, we say when we first get saved, give your testimony. And then we kind of do that for a year or so. And once you've been a Christian for a few years, we stop asking you, unless it was a good testimony. But actually, you have a testimony right from your birth to today. It's just whether you've seen what God is doing in you or not is another matter. And so one of the things that we try and get people to do is to start to engage with the Lord in that sense where you're asking him to reveal to you what your story is about. Because your story carries an incredible authority in the Spirit. says in Revelation they overcame by the word of their testimony, by the blood of the Lamb, and that they didn't love their lives even to death. I think it is absolutely incredible. Can you just think about this? That he puts your testimony next to the blood of the Lamb and that they didn't love their lives even to death. Isn't that incredible? He puts, because actually there is power in your testimony. When you have overcome something, you have an absolute authority in that area. It says of Jesus that filled with the Holy Spirit, he goes into the wilderness. Here he encounters the devil and wins some victories and comes back full of the power of the Holy Spirit, because there is power in the victories in our lives. Those victories in our lives are part of the story of who you've been made in Christ. Okay? We need to become conscious of the victories that have been won for us, because it is one of the places that we find personally that we have been given authority and power. They become the roots and the places, the victories that have been won by Jesus in us. And of course, the big one is when you got saved. But actually, there are all sorts of points through life. So what I want to encourage you to do, over the next couple of weeks, is actually you can see the image of God. We can all behold him. You can sit down in your room and you can say, this is just navel-gazing silly stuff, but I'll have a go, you know. Okay, Lord, I want to be able to see you. I want to start to engage with you. Because actually it says that we are, as we see that image, we're being transformed into his image. There's a transformation that comes as we seek to see that image, to have revelation of him. He then starts to speak back to us. Let him remind you of your victories. I started keeping a journal when the Lord started to say, I need you to walk in more spiritual authority. I wish I'd done it years and years ago, because it's so much clearer to see the patterns emerging. Because you forget things. You forget when he answered prayer. Okay. And if we don't remember when he answered prayer, we lose the sense of the story that he's writing about us. Okay. We don't therefore understand the authority he's given us. So start keeping a journal. Start writing some stuff down. Talk to the Lord. Say, who am I? What were the key events? Let him remind you. And start to get a real sense of who he has made you in Jesus. Where are your victories? Okay. Because as you do, you have a much greater and greater fruitfulness in who you are. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. One of the things that we sometimes miss is that it says in Scripture that he came to save our souls. Not our spirits, not our bodies. You know, those come secondary. The key thing was our soul. What's in your soul? Well, your soul is shaped by the life you've lived. Have you ever thought about that? What Jesus is actually taking is your stories and your testimonies. What he has so valued is not the immediate atoms of your body that make your body. Actually, it's your soul which carries your history. And he has put the value of the blood of the Lamb on those things. Put the blood of Jesus. So one of the things I really encourage folks is to become more aware of who they are in Christ. Okay? As you become more aware of who you are in Christ, you understand where he wants you to go. It says a righteous person is like a tree planted by a stream that bears fruit in season. You know, if you know where you've been planted, why you should be who you are, okay, you are planted by the stream. It feeds you. You will bear fruit. You'll bear fruit. So we spent a long time this evening, haven't we? I'm just going to pray corporately. In 2 weeks' time, what we want to do is we want to prophetically give you oil. We want to prophetically lay hands on everybody and say, be fruitful in ministering the Holy Spirit into people's lives. So, Father, I just want to thank you. You are a good Father. Father, I thank you that you did not leave us as orphans, but that you have sent your Holy Spirit to clothe us in the victory of the resurrected and ascended Jesus, who is the image of man, sat down at the right hand of the Father and brings the image of man into the image of God. You are our great high priest, Lord Jesus, and we are clothed in you, and we share your sonship. We share the authority that you won on the cross. And Lord Jesus, I want to pray, Lord, for this church. I want to declare for this church, Lord, not just to pray that it might happen. I want to declare for this church that even tonight is just part of a journey which, Lord, there has been hearts been setting on. Lord, that we cannot know sometimes where the end of the journey is going to be like. But we set out on it knowing it's the right direction and the right course. I want to declare, Lord Jesus, in this church that it becomes known for every member with authority, every member with authority, that Lord, the members of this church have learnt about their sonship, that have understood and learnt the tools to hear what the Spirit is saying, that have got hold of the testimonies that release the power of Jesus, that overcome the devil because of the word of their testimonies, the words of their life story, and the blood of the Lamb, and that they don't love their lives even to death, because that's the other thing, is but let's not go there. But Father, I want to declare it. I want to declare it, Lord Jesus, not as a hope, but Lord, as this is what the destiny of this church is. Lord, it says that you, when you laid hold of us, those that you foreknew, you had predestined to become conformed to the image of your Son. And Lord, that image is one that carries authority, Lord Jesus. That is part of why you have saved us. You have saved us to step into the image that Jesus has authored for us of what humanity should look like. And so in Jesus' name, we declare it into the heavenlies. Amen. We declare it to those spirits that are assigned against this church to stop it becoming everything it should be in Jesus. Lord, we declare it to those kind of spirits that are like a fungus that attach themselves to our hurts and our pains and try and sap our strength. And we declare to those things that you are a thief and you are a robber. You are a thief and you are a robber. And Jesus has come to release us into abundant life, into an abundant life. And Father, we say, Lord Jesus, that what you have paid for, you will take, Lord Jesus, from this place, Lord Jesus. That the cross, Lord Jesus, and the blood that was paid for each life here, Lord Jesus, will not just reap, Lord Jesus, the life for eternity, but will reap the life in all of its fullness, all of the expression of what it has been made it to be in you. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. We'll let and release, folks. There are some tapes that we've done in the past on some of these subjects at the back, if anyone wants to see those. But Dave and I would love to stay around and pray for anybody who would like specific prayer as well. Is that right, Dave?
Yes.
It is. It is good. I'll hand back. Oh, there's David. Do you want to say, David?
Thank you, Christen. Thank you. Let's just share appreciation for them. Yeah. Good. So if you do want to be prayed for, do stay around. Do take hold of what has been said tonight. Think about it. Pray about it. Come back in 2 weeks' time, but not exactly as you are now, but between now and 2 weeks' time, having begun to put into practice in your own life, in your walk with God, and in your walk with people around in Tesco's or wherever it is that you go. And so as you come back in 2 weeks' time, you're ready for some more from God and to see release. And this is about specifically in the short term what we're doing in the Easter outreach. We're going to 2,000 houses in the local area and offering to pray for people, as well as the stuff we're doing on the streets. So this is what our focus is around. But we're not waiting until we get to that before we begin to do the stuff that God's releasing in us. Amen?
Amen.
So let's walk in it, let's do it, and let's see an outpouring and release of God in our lives and through our lives into this community which God has set us. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.